Wow. We said 8:30. I'm not sure where they're at. This might be them. What happened? I said 8:30. Where have you been?
It's 8:31.
No, it's 8:35.
It's good. Don't worry about it. Don't stress about stuff, okay?
Well, we said.
It's okay.
We said.
Remember?
I had my day planned.
I know, but look, who are we waiting on again? Miss Honor.
Mm-hmm.
Does anybody understand what Honor's about? Mm-hmm. Yeah, Miss Honor, late. Yep.
No, yeah, I know. I really have to.
Absolutely right.
Yes. Oh my gosh.
I know. I'm with
you. Our day is messed up because we are late.
Oh, hi, girls. Yeah. Just
hello. We're over here.
Shut the phone off.
No,
it's our meeting. Our time is valuable to us.
Okay,
bye-bye. Thank you.
Do I look all right? I just thought
you do look all right.
I don't know. I just got my makeup. Where's
nobody's going to see us. It's just a meeting. It's between the three of us.
Put your stuff away.
Yes.
Put
your stuff away.
Okay. Oh, all right. I came up with this great. All right. Okay. So I came up with this really great idea. Oh my gosh. I was visiting my mom and she came up with this key. Check that out.
Whoa.
Yeah. What are you thinking of that?
Simple.
What are you going to do with it?
Well, I was thinking
that's not part of our plan.
Well, I was thinking that maybe we could just like.
There's too many teeth on
but
it.
Yes.
This would be good for stuff.
Do that again.
Go back to the plan.
Oh. Simple.
The plan. People, let's stay
plan,
on track.
The truth and the light.
Right.
Father,
I did tell you about that.
Son and Holy Spirit.
Hey, that was
Spirit.
Like my idea in the very beginning.
Joni, Pastor Pat, Anna, Pastor Lori, me. Stuff.
There's too much
that's
stuff.
That's why I need this key. All right, fine. I'll put it with my other stuff. Okay.
Let's just stick to the plan.
Yeah. Stick to the plan.
Stick
okay.
to the plan.
Yes, owl. Yes.
Hey, what is the plan?
Lion, what do you see you need to get done?
I'm just ready. You guys asked too many questions, and well, I want to get her done.
I need to know. I need to know what we're doing.
I got it. I got your back.
No, I need
I'm
to
sure
know.
The video's going to happen. I'm going to stay in the back. Everything's going to be good.
Totally. I'm telling you, we need to change lunch up, okay? Because lunch... We
no.
can't just have people just making stuff. And so I called Goodies and I called this other place and they said, hey, we can do it for $5 and nobody has to bake anything or anything. And what do you think of that idea? Because I just think it would be really, really nice.
Here.
I need to think about it. This is too much information. I need to think about it. We need to plan this out.
And not
be
only that,
flexible.
Stick to the plan. Stick to the plan.
That's right. We already know what we're doing. The ladies, this is part of their ministry. We already decided it. We're not going to change the plan now. It's good.
Stick to the plan.
We can do that. I can do that, Lord. Okay, yes.
This is good.
All right, look, you guys are really teaching me a lot of stuff. I'm just really out there
so
sometimes.
Glad.
Well, you have to learn some of that.
I get some of it. I got it.
Yeah, I know.
I do, but... I want to get her done. If we have a meeting after a meeting after a meeting, we already know we don't have to go over the same things over and over and over again. We got it.
And if we have a plan, we can get her done.
The Holy Spirit, right?
Always. Just watch out for her.
I know.
You gotta try.
So what were the questions that you had?
Come on,
I knew
just
that
try
I'm
it.
Not gonna hurt her.
Come on, just
she
try
just
it.
Got prayed for.
Just try. That wasn't even nothing.
She's the entertainment.
Okay, tell me what we're doing.
She's the owl. She has to make sure that we have everything just so. She
just
asks all
plan.
The questions.
We have a plan.
And I just want
to detail before we do anything.
Yes. And that is how Keys came about.
Well, guess what, Edie?
What?
I got the right time.
Now's the time. Now's our time.
It's our turn to announce our pastor. I'm going to announce her how I announce her to strangers. Over the years, I've been just in total awe of what God has done in Pastor Joyce. I tell people that she's a contemporary Paul, but instead of falling off a horse, she fell off a motorcycle. And just like Paul, she loved God before she fell off the motorcycle. You know, Paul loved God. He just didn't believe in Jesus. And it's not that she didn't believe in Jesus, but I mean, she loved God. But when she fell off that motorcycle and was blinded, the same kind of revelation that happened to Paul has happened to her, and she has totally, totally been transformed into the purpose that God had for her life. And I was thinking as we're singing that song, repairing what was broken so I may fly again. Yes. And there was this broken Joyce riding on a motorcycle, and she fell off of it and was blinded. And he restored. And what we see now is beyond my comprehension because I've seen it totally God. Nothing man, nothing but the Spirit of God. And it is truly an honor to call her my pastor. So for those that you don't know her, her name is Pastor Joyce McKay, or Newman. Oh my gosh, I'm sorry, Dan. And tomorrow's their anniversary. How dare I? Spank me. But it's only been a year. Yeah, take that one. You got to take it. So, but Edie has a few words she'd like to say about our pastor.
I didn't know I had to do this. Otherwise, I would have wrote out a big page or something. Oh, yeah. I go way back, and I remember when she walked in the doors of that church, little broken Joyce. And she came in all broken with a motorcycle jacket and, you know, stay away from me, you know. God kind of brought us together, and we kind of rallied around her, and we'd meet once a week and we'd pray for years. We'd go down to the beach and pray, and Jan and I would be in there praying, and Pastor would be in the back seat. And she'd say, I've done this. I've got this. I've been here. And I'd say, God's going to use it someday. And so we had the privilege of watching God transform her from a motorcycle babe to a godly woman.
Amen.
And I remember watching her in church, and she'd be the first one at the altar, and God would say, kneel down. She'd kneel down, and I'd be watching her, and I'd be saying, man, I'm not that obedient. Uh-huh. You know, he's got to ask me 3 or 4 times before I kind of like do that. But I mean, Pastor Joyce was always obedient and willing to be transparent from day one. And as I watch her being transformed and transformed and transformed, I don't know if I like it sometimes because she's changed. I don't like change. But she's just changed, and she keeps on changing and changing and changing, and she's doing it for him. So we get to watch her being transformed into a different person.
The one God created her to be.
Yep, that's the one that God created her to be. So we introduce our friend, our pastor, best buddies, Pastor Joyce.
So one of the transformations that God's done in my life is I used to dance. I used to teach dance, country dance. But I used to dance at the bars quite a bit. And you know, in the world, you're taught to draw attention to yourself, to your body. It's not what it was meant. You know, and sometimes when ladies come in and they start dancing before the Lord and they got everything moving, be gentle, because they don't know any better.
Right.
You know, God spoke to my heart and he said, you know what? They don't know. That's why it's so easy to minister in love, because I remember those times.
But I remember when I was taken the first time, it was actually at Beacon Church. And Janine's like, come on, you gotta come and see this dance. You know, do you like to dance? Oh yeah. Okay, we got something, we think. And that's how the Lord, what he used to pull me in. So we went to this church and we watched this beautiful team of dancers. But one of them stuck out to me. And I will tell you, she was drawing attention to herself. When you dance before the Lord as a team, you dance to the ability of the weakest dancer. That's humility. If you do it on your own and you don't care what anybody else is doing, as long as you got it right, you need to give that to the Lord. I remember sitting there and saying, Lord, don't ever let me get up there until I can draw attention to you instead of me. And we started working on a dance, and we did it the very first time in this church on this stage 2 years later. That's how long our transformation takes a while. But when you got it, you got it. So some of the ladies didn't know what I was going to dance or what I was going to do. But even as they talked about change and how it's changed my life and who I am and how God has changed me, the name of this song is called Shades of You. And so I just ask you to not look at the dance, because it's never about the dance, but it's about the anointing that is in the atmosphere of his presence. And this is unto him, but it's for all of you after him.
You are the potter, and I am the clay.
excited because I got the life part. And the girls got to share a little bit about, you know, my past and a little bit about who I used to be. But, you know, I didn't even realize that obedience was a requirement of the Lord. I just knew that the first time that I walked into a church that was spirit-filled, it was a little spooky to me, but yet I was drawn by it. You know, I wasn't used to the move of the Holy Spirit. I wasn't used to walking into life. I was used to walking into darkness, and darkness always welcomed me. It's important that the churches welcome people. Yes. And so I walked into a church where I was welcomed with ripped up jeans, really, really, really tight clothes, kind of see-through shirts, and a Harley Davidson jacket and an attitude to match. And of course, nobody really shunned me. I mean, people just embraced me, and they loved all the imperfections, all the rough edges about me. And I still have a lot of rough edges, but that's kind of like part of my personality too. Part of the lion is I'm just a getter done kind of person. I was a troubleshooter in the world. I would go in and I could fix problems. I didn't have to be an owl and have all the details. Pastor Lori has to have all the details. And that's a wonderful, wonderful gift to have. And that's why he pulled the strengths of all three of our gifts out. And this one over here likes to clown around. She does go to orbit and back. And she told on herself in one of our first or second meetings, she goes, well, my husband just really loves me. And he just has a way of bringing me back to earth. And so being the lion that I am, I ate that. I'm like, okay, that is a secret told, okay? And so, but it helped me to love her and to be able to bring something, to bring her back to simple, because she is very, you know, artistic, and she just, it's beautiful to have. And so so that's why he pulled on all of us. And so we all grew in this journey together. We all grow in the Spirit of God, and we grow in the Spirit of love, because He is love, right? Amen. And I just want to share something really quick before I go into what God has given me today. While I was in the back, again, lion personality, I'm in the back, I'm running the video, I'm there in case somebody comes in the back door, not because anybody asked me to, that's my personality. I'm watching over everything. I'm making sure that people have water, and that, you know, that's just what I do. That's part of this type of a personality. Why other people can be up here worshiping, I can only be here so long, and my brain goes into action. All right, we've got to keep things going, we got to keep things running. I'm an administrator, I have the gift of that. I also was a director of operations, this Harley person that had a really bad attitude. I have gifts from God. You know, even though I didn't have a really good time in school, I was a class clown, was kicked out more than I should have been, but I was anyways. I was high most of the time in high school because I was trying to hide my inabilities. And so, you know, but yet there was gifts. There was something hidden in the rough. You know, and only the Lord sees what's hidden in your rough. You know, does anybody got some rough in here today? I mean, I'm going to just speak it out. Aaron, you're a diamond in the rough. I just got to tell you that. Do you understand that? You are. And I've just got to be obedient to the Holy Spirit. There's some of us in this room that are really guarded, you know, and your body language tells it all, you know, but also your personality, you know, and sometimes it'll show your insecurities, but it's okay because it's safe in here, right? I mean, God is good. And I didn't realize that there was life. There was life in serving Him. There was life in fellowship with other believers. There was life in dying to yourself. You know, it says, not I that live, but now it's Christ that lives in me. That's what's going on here, let me tell you. Because I've been dying to my flesh. I've been dying to myself. And I have allowed the Lord to just chisel away on me. Amen. Hasn't been easy. Yes. Sometimes He uses people, you know. He uses people, and sometimes we can get offended, and we just got to step back, because I'll tell you what, if you got an offendable spirit, the Lord's going to let you get offended until you give it up. One of the ladies I asked yesterday, I said, so did you get rid of your stuff? She goes, I didn't have any. I just went, Okay, that's danger, danger, danger. And, you know, and I didn't think anything. I was just like, okay, Lord, you got to show. You're the only one that can show stuff. Because in life and even in ministry and as Christians, if you've been a Christian your whole life or just for 10 years, you think you just got it all down. You're just, you got it, you know. Everybody else needs to get up there. I'm telling you, I was the one, I was sitting on the edge of my seat. I was the first one to get up there and get prayed for. I knew somebody told him about me. So I was up here. And then when I didn't think I needed to be up here, I said
to you just a minute going forward. And this is in Ephesians 3, starting in verse 14. And when you said Ephesians 2, I was like, whew. Says, for this reason I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, from who the whole family in heaven and on earth is named, that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might through his spirit in your inner man. Amen. For all of us that know this, some of us may not know this, but when we ask Jesus in our hearts to be our Savior, he truly does come in and live. The Word of God says that he will come in and he will remove that heart of stone that you have. And he will replace it with a heart of flesh. It also says that he will give you a new spirit. That means we had an old spirit. And not only that, he says, I'll come in and live and join that spirit. See, in our inner man is our knower. We have to get past our own understanding to go further in the things of Christ. Yes. And I had to learn that, and I was a process, just like many of you are. And God is good. So let me just go a little bit further. That Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. That's why faith is so important. You know, the devil is coming and robbing people's faith, and he is putting fear on you. And I prayed for a couple people about fear today, because fear is a spirit. There's a kingdom of darkness, and there's a kingdom of light. And in the kingdom of hell comes fear. If you give life to that fear, that's where you put your faith, is in fear, that is going to have power over your life. But if you put faith in your faith for the good things, for the abundant life, for what God says about you, many things Pastor Lori brought out, what he says about you versus what you even say about yourself when you're looking in the mirror. The Word of God says that life and death is in the power of our tongues. So if you're looking in the mirror and you're saying, oh, I don't have what she has, and you're so focused on her, that is covetousness. That is envy. It brings strife. It brings division into the churches. We are not to be the same. Amen. We are the master. He is the master, and we are his masterpieces, just like it was brought out today. Truly, truly, truly. I didn't know that. You know, part of my whole biker thing was nothing but to protect myself from the world. It was to protect myself from the hurt that I already had endured. And I just thought if I just got tough on the outside, nobody would ever really know what is on the inside. And nobody's ever going to be able to hurt me again. But yet I was so broken, and I was so hurt, and it didn't stop me from getting hurt again. Mm-hmm. Leather does not protect the heart. It only protects the skin. Skin is flesh. Let me go on. So it says that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you be rooted and grounded in love. Pastor Joni and Pastor Lori both talked about love. One of the things that I say at River of Life all the time, we have a unique ministry there, so I say a lot of the same things because that's what God has done there. But we talk about love all the time because he is love. And the love of this world has so distorted what love really is that it makes it hard for people to trust the love of God because they judge the love of God by looking at us. Right. And about things in our past. Right. And we can't do that. Right.
So what's happening? The Lord is busting out all over the place. He is showing what love really is. People are embracing it. I embraced it. It took me a while, but I embraced it. But when I realized that God loved me, and I really realized that God loved me, nobody could take that from me anymore. It wasn't about religion. It wasn't about what I could do and what I couldn't do. It wasn't about if I was good enough or little enough or fancy enough. And I sure can't read, right? So all the people that sit underneath my teaching, they know that. And they love me anyways. And I'm not afraid of that. And let me tell you how good God is. I was asked to speak at a church here in Manistee, and there was a lot of people that I'm going to say know a whole lot more than me when it comes to knowledge and that are educated. And I walked into that church, and they said, oh, yeah, remember, Pastor Joyce, you said that you would read this piece. I did, didn't I? But I thought I was going to get a little bit of warning so I could go home and practice. But you know how good God is? And people witness this. I read like a pro. I come down off from that place, and even some people met me in the back and said, I know that was God. It's not that I can't read. It's the way that I read. But the Lord was going to protect me from all the naysayers. I'm going to tell you something. I'm a female pastor that was called by God. I wasn't called by man. I was called by God. And my pastor said, it's about time you step up and be in who you're called to be. Because I was afraid of it. God isn't a respecter of persons. He made all of us in His image. I want you to know that I got a hold of the life. And I want to share something. I am rooted and grounded in love. I'm rooted and grounded in His love. Do I still hurt people sometimes? Do I make mistakes? I do. Oh boy. But He is able. So I am rooted and grounded in love. May be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width and the length and the depth and the height, to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge. If you try to figure it out, you're not going to understand it. You will never understand His love in your knowledge. You have to just receive it by faith and start confessing with your mouth who you really are, that you may be filled with the fullness of God. You're not going to get any more of God than what I have or you have. It just might look a little bit different on you than what I have, but it's still His fullness. He died once for all sin. He is the only way. He is the truth, and He is the life. Apart from Him, there is nothing. I loved last night because I was able to give that first key away and talk about the truth, or talk about the way. And it was so cool because there is only one way. And it's Him. You see, when I was a little girl, I asked the Lord to be my Savior. And I will tell you ladies right now, I know that if I would have died before I got set free, I would have went to heaven. I know that. Nobody can take that from me. When I truly asked the Lord to be my Lord and Savior, I meant it. And I never forgot it. I just didn't know how to live for Him. I didn't know about the abundant life. I didn't know how to do the things. And I was too young to really understand the voice of the Lord. But yet there was always something tugging at me throughout my life. I was kind of like in and out, in and out. You know, my kids got to be in church the first few years of their life. And, you know, I just could not receive love. I didn't understand it. But then the Lord started teaching me. Please don't speak if somebody is going to go to hell or to heaven, unless you know without a doubt from the Lord. Because if somebody would have looked at me, I might not have got to the same level as Pastor Joni. But I would at least got in there, because my heart was pure to Him, according to the measure of faith that I had. But I never let it grow. And some of us sitting in here,
have not allowed what you have asked the Lord to do in your life to grow. And we need to do that. I don't want to hit any more walls, and I don't know about anybody else in this place, but they aren't any fun. Amen. And I hit enough of them. And I was driving down the road one day, and I heard the Lord say, and I was crying out, and I was complaining, and He said, "Have you had enough yet, Joyce?" I have had enough. But I meant it that time. It's not that He put these things in my life. It's the decisions that I made. And when He was trying to stop me, I did it anyways. When I first got set free, I started journaling and reading the Word, and I got the Word all messed up because I made it work for me. You can do that, you know. You can make the Word work for you, and I did that plenty of times. But in that, as I journaled, I started realizing that, oh, I guess no means no. Okay. I can't make it be for me. I have to let it be what you're saying it is, and it's the truth. Mm-hmm. You can't distort the truth and twist the truth. If you want to have the abundant life, you have got to go the way. You have got to live the truth, and you will have the abundant life that God speaks about. I have the abundant life. I want you to know that. And I'm bragging. I got bragging rights. I'm bragging. But I'm boasting in the Lord, and it isn't because of anything that I've ever done. It's all because of what He is doing and done through me. He gets all the glory in Jesus' name. He says, "I am the true vine." Not Jan. Not Christine. Him. He might put people in our lives for us, but we better keep our eyes on Christ. I remember when I started growing up, and I had an issue, and all of a sudden I'm driving down the road, and I'm like, "I'm going to call Jan. I'm just going over to Jan's." And the Lord said, "Don't you dare. It's between me and you now. It's time for you to come to me." So I had to sacrifice an Isaac that I didn't even know that I had, which was Jan, which was Edie. Because they became more important. They become the voice of God more than His voice. And you see, it was time for me to feed off from Him.
Right. Yeah.
Still let them be used in my life, and all of you ladies be used in my life, but I needed to get real with God and get personal with God to a greater level, because I wasn't going to be able to rise any higher if I didn't stop rising on somebody else. Mm-hmm. Amen. He says, "I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, He takes away." I'm going to tell you what, I have had more pruning done than I think anybody in this room. I am serious. But I'm not a gardener, but I do know that when you cut away, new life comes.
Right.
So some of the things that you ladies are writing down, the things that God's revealing to you, that's pruning, because they're not producing fruit in your life.
Good.
They're not producing fruit in your life. So if they're not producing fruit in your life, then that part of your life is not attached to the true vine, which is God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hurts though, doesn't it? Ha! Pride. Oh, I'm not prideful. Oh yeah, I ain't got no junk. Okay, I ain't got no junk. During this, our little process, Joni got a hold of me and said, "I just got to say something that I think, I just have this stuff. And I just got to say it because I see it. The Lord revealed it to me. And she wanted me to know." So I took that as an honor, because the Word says, "Confess your sins one to another and pray healing." And that's what we did. God gives you somebody safe because He's safe. This morning I woke up, I did a lot of crying before I ever got here because the Holy Spirit was so on me this morning. And I said, "You know, He's gentle." Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not one of these people that thinks everything is good, but in Christ, all things are good. But I want you to understand that God is very gentle, and sometimes we don't allow Him to be gentle through us. We become very judgmental, we become critical, and we hurt his people. Nobody in this room does that, though. When I went away this past fall, God showed me that I was harsh with some people. You know, and I could have just blown that off. But I repented. Because you want to know something? He knew that's never my heart, because his heart beats in my chest. Because what he is, I am. Because I am attached to the vine. And my Father is the vine dresser. And he is the one that has changed me from the inside out. I want to talk about something today, just really quickly. I just want to show you this black scarf. Now, we do this dance. It's called Mercy Seat, I think. I don't know. Yeah. And so this is the darkness in that song. But this right here represented me. Now, you can see through it, but what if you couldn't? It'd be really dark, right? Can we see somebody beyond their darkness? When the Lord started transforming my life, he took a really dirty, nasty rock, which was called Joyce. I was telling a story this morning about an incident, and I said, you know, after I had this confrontation, I was so angry and I was so mad, and I couldn't even function. Dan had to do Bible study, and I called up Pastor Joni and I said, do you got a minute? And she came to my rescue, and you want to know what it was? I was so angry because I wanted to beat this person up. Literally, I wanted to beat this person up, and I wanted to beat this person up like really, really bad, and I would have done it not very long ago, like less than 12 years ago, and they would not have looked the same. I guarantee it. I might look little, but there is a lion beyond this skin that you see. But I had to die to my flesh. I had to die and be gentle. I didn't have to take it anymore, but I had to get rid of that, because that old man wanted to rise up really, really bad. And I wasn't going to just put on a mask and my makeup and go to church and pretend like it was all better when I had stuff that I had to deal with. And I knew in Christ who I am, and I know in whom I believe. And whatever I commit into his hands, he is able to keep. But am I going to commit it? So I called Joni, the little otter. Here we go. Come on, let's go have some fun. Here I go. You don't get it. You don't know how angry I am. This has really hurt me enough. But yet, oh my God. That's how I was with somebody else. Remember that part? I said, Lord, thank you for showing me. Thank you for showing me. You think we grow in those times? I will tell you, I crucified my flesh. I avoid that person at all costs. Not because I'm afraid, because I'm not. But he that is in me is greater than he that is in the world. Can you relate? So that was a big chip on the stone that is still not quite perfected yet. But God is transforming me from the inside out. And so what he is making me into is a beautiful diamond. But do you know how painful every one of these little chips and cuts to make this diamond shine so beautifully? I got it a little messed up. I've been sweating and crying all over it, right? But it's gorgeous. God does not create junk.
That's right.
And I want you to know that he's taught me how to love. Because you see, if I'm rooted and grounded in love, first of all, I have to understand that he loves me, right? And then the word says that to love your neighbor as you love yourself. Well, listen, God's tricky. Because if you don't love yourself first, how can you love your neighbor? So love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your might, and every part of your being. And because of that, because he lives inside of you, the abundant life is that you carry love. You carry him. And he's attached to your spirit that he's given you, which is love. So now you can love yourself regardless of what's been spoken over you or spoken about you. Don't read the devil's mail. Social media is hurting people. Don't read the devil's mail. If somebody's texting you bad things, block them. Mm-hmm. Right? Block them. Don't let them speak about you the way that they do, even to you. It's the devil in disguise. So because I have love in me, now I have grace, and I have mercy, and I have peace. Shades of you. I wrote down the lyrics this morning. I did it on that new program Pastor Lori showed me about. It says, you are the potter and I am the clay. Will you let him be the potter of your life? Will you really be the clay? Do you know how many times you got to spin around on a potter's wheel? And then it talks about us being an empty vessel and how he is the fire. We do have to go through the fire. But we come out very beautiful. We might start out like this. Somebody's throwaway, somebody's rag, somebody's opinion. And it might look like this in the beginning. But if we just let God, Amanda, the Lord says, this is over. This is over. This has been part of the process for this. Okay? It says, you are the artist and I am the paint. Will you be the paint? Will you let him mix you up a little bit? Will you? Oh my gosh, the writer. God gave Pastor Lori a letter for every lady in this room. He's the writer, but you're his song. Is he our song? Mold me, huh? Change me, oh yeah. Color me. The best part, in shades of you. In shades of you, Lord. What does that look like? Look at your neighbor. Look at your neighbor. You are shades of him. We're not supposed to look the same. We're not supposed to be the same. He is the potter. He is the master. That's why we all have a master key, because he is the way, the truth, and the life. And he's the one that has to have us completely surrendered unto him in order for him to really do anything for us. He gives us peace when things are havoc, when our circumstances are horrible. We still can have peace. We can still stand and be steadfast in him, because he is the way, he is the truth, and he is the life. But you got to stay attached to the vine. Otherwise, there is no life. You've got to receive it from him, from the master, from our Father God, from him and him alone. He will use people, but understand, people are people. They do have anointings, but you don't want to see me on a day I'm not in tune with the Lord. Those are the days I'm in the woodshed with him. and they're not pretty. But I wouldn't trade them for nothing. There is discipline and correction in love. And sometimes you get mad at your pastors and you get an attitude. Well, you need to get over it. It's not your pastor, it's your Father working through them. And if it's your pastor, God is going to take them to the woodshed. And it'll be a whole lot worse for them than it ever was for you. Because they are held accountable for you. That is a serious, serious call. What you see up here is nothing. This is just the fruit of the labor. There's a lot of labor that goes behind the scenes to minister the gospel, to minister to somebody, because you're all called. You might not be called to be a pastor, but you're called to bring life. Yes. Yes. And life abundantly. Is it adding to you or is it subtracting? Now, if it's God, He's going to do a cutting away. There's a difference. We have wisdom and discernment, because the gift to us from the Lord, from God our Father, is the Holy Spirit. Yes. The Holy Spirit has gifts that are within us, and He brings them out of us as He wills. So wait for Him. Let Him do it. It's a lot less painful. You see, what the Lord showed me about my life, how does a jeweler display their most precious gem? Can you hold this? Can you hold this? With black. So the black represents our past, our stuff. The diamond is who you really are. So don't be afraid of your past anymore. Use them for God's glory and be thankful for them. Don't let the devil keep hurting you anymore. Don't let him take what happened to you a year ago or 6 years ago or 20 years ago and keep you in bondage in prison, because you have all been given the way, the truth, and the life. Yes. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Amen. Father, I thank you and praise you, Lord, for each lady that is here tonight, today. And we ask, God, that you touch them and bless them. Yes. And Father God, that they see themselves now in a new light. Thank you, Jesus. Because you are the vine. Yes. And the Father's the vine dresser, nobody else. You will trim away when needed. But you are the one that gives life, and life abundantly. So I pray today, Father, that you just bless each lady here as they go into the room of intimacy with you. Yes. And they find a peace in there that represents who they are from you. We love you and praise you in Jesus' name. All God's people said, amen. Amen. So what's going to happen now is... Christine, can you grab that basket behind there? Ladies, first of all, we are blessed by you. But what God has showed me in that room now of intimacy, you need to go in there. And before you go in, you're going to take one of these. And it says... just what this was all about today. It says, Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. And inside that room is a diamond for you. There's a bowl in there for your keys, your junk, your paper that you've been writing down. And it's at the foot of the cross, and you can drop them off in there. And you leave it there, and you find there's a lot of different diamonds in there, different sizes. But what you're looking for It's a heart. There's one for everyone in here. Please don't take more than one. That's all you're looking for, is your diamond. It's a heart, and it has a little loop on it that you can hook on your key. The paper keys represent the black path, and you'll find your diamond, who you really are inside. And we also have communion in there at the foot of the cross. For those of you that want to take communion, the grape represents the blood. The crushing of the grape. Here, sweetie.
The crushing of the grape brought our healing.
And the bread
represents the body that Jesus died for us.
And the word is in there. So the diamond represents the life that you have in Christ.
Just entered it in a new level of intimacy. Amen.